this is such an honour and a treat to introduce a good friend of mine, infamous NSA whistleblower. Mm. And from next year, when the film of his life story is coming out, which is called A Good American, a very famous whistleblower. So look out for that film. I gather it's spectacularly good. Bill Binney needs very little introduction, I think. He served for 30 years in the NSA, which is the American snooping agency, or no such agency, I think it used to be called.
I refer to it as the new Stasi agency.
That, I'm going to keep that one. That's great. And he reached the rank of technical director. Now we're very honoured to have Bill Binney as our Code Red technical director, which is a fantastic step up, I think, in his career trajectory.
Yes.
Without any more words, I will let Bill describe and talk about everything he wants to, because I couldn't say it better than he will. Bill.
Thank you. Thank you, Annie. Yes, it's my pleasure to be here. And what I've done in the world is, after I've retired from NSA, and because they were spying on everybody, not just in first they started bulk acquisition of data against U.S. citizens. That was a violation of our Constitution and all the laws we had protecting privacy and liberty and so on. So, I mean, I couldn't stay there. It took me 2.5 weeks to leave the place after I found out that was going on. Then I went to our standard reporting channels up to the intelligence committees, who were supposed to be, they were chartered based from the, as a result of the Church Committee investigations into NSA, FBI, and CIA. During the Nixon administration in the 60s and 70s, they were spying on U.S. citizens, and because of that, Nixon was impeached. But they created these intelligence committees and also the FISA court as a way of a mechanism of monitoring the intelligence community and make sure that they didn't spy on U.S. citizens. Well, that of course, was absolutely, that worked for a while. But up after, in the late 80s, it started shifting, and after a lot of the contracting started from the Reagan, I mean, he plussed up the agencies with a lot of money, so that started a lot of contracting, and then they started to lag, the rules started to fall apart at that point, and then when 9/11 happened, they just threw everything out the window. In fact, as you were mentioning earlier about the Patriot Act, actually, I think they started the Patriot Act before 9/11. So that they actually, in fact, they were approaching the, I know Joe Nachio, who used to be the CEO of Quest, the telecommunications company in the U.S., that was approached on the 27th of February of 2001 to turn over all the material on all his customers in the U.S. And he refused and basically said, if you come back with a warrant signed by a judge, I'll do it. Well, they never did. Okay, and so one of the things they did was they actually framed him and put him in jail for 5 years. And that meant, that was the message to all other CEOs of telecommunications companies and IPs, that you either cooperate or we'll find a way to take care of you. So that was exactly what they did with that. So, in fact, when I Edward Snowden started releasing this material, it was pretty clear to me, somebody who knew something about these programs, since I designed most of them or had a hand in it, needed to explain it to people so they could understand what this really meant, you know? Most people don't, I mean, it's just program after program, and nobody really sees what that is, and these are just really simply the different names for a function. And the function is what you have to do. If it's voice collection using phones or IP, voice over IP, that's one function. Or if it's text collection or if it's satellites or whatever, it's different functions. But the collection is fundamentally of the ways people communicate, voice, typing, and visual. And that's all it is. And each different source of information has a different name, and it gets... That's by design, by the way. NSA does that so that even Congress can't realize what they're doing, because they bamboozle them all the time. They're duping them and playing them for fools, just like all these other agencies around the world are playing their governments for fools, because they don't understand what they're doing either. And so that gives them the advantage of being able to manipulate them. And that's fundamentally what's happening all over the world. I mean, even the Bundestag is now finding out the BND was transferring data on German citizens to NSA. So, I mean, that's a violation of their laws. So this has been going on, and very few people in German government knew about this. The same was true in the U.S. government. Not many people originally knew what was happening. Only four originally. That was the chair and ranking members of the House and Senate Intelligence Committee. That was it until early 2002. About 5 months in, they went to the senior judge on the FISA court. then that was it until the exposure in the New York Times. So they were trying to keep an uninformed Congress and an uninformed public so they could manipulate and control and get more money and do whatever they wanted by the claims that others have talked about here about we've stopped so many terrorist attacks, you know. Well, in the U.S., that was claimed too, and General Alexander had to defend that in Senator Leahy's committee, the Senate Judiciary Committee, and as a result of that, he claimed stopped 54 attacks. And as a result of the investigation, he was pushed to prove that, and he ended up with one. And that one was a transfer of $8,500 from someone on the West Coast to somebody in Al-Shabaab in Africa. Well, that's not a domestic issue, right? That was an international transfer. So the answer about the domestic program is zero. And that's where it stood. But so anyway, when I first started to try to talk about these, using some of the material from Edward Snowden to try to give people the understanding of what they really meant, General Clapper, who's the Director of National Intelligence, issued an order saying, no members of the current or former members of the intelligence community are permitted to talk about any of the material that Snowden has released. So I answered him in the National Press Club. I said, I do not give up my First Amendment rights to talk about anything in the public domain for anybody. And I haven't heard from General Clapper since. So, but at any rate, this is the one of the first publications that came out from Edward Snowden talking about the PRISM program. And it talked about all those companies transferring data upon request to NSA. But really, there was another program behind it called Muscular, where NSA had a secret tap on their transfer on the fiber optic lines between their data centers, so they were capturing everything they had as they transferred it. It wasn't just a little bit they were after from the PRISM program. They wanted everything out of their databases. So, and the point here is, the real program is not the PRISM program, it's the upstream program. And that's components to Fairview, Stormbrew, Blarney, and Oakstar. Well, Fairview is AT&T, Stormbrew is Verizon, that's the major two major companies in the telecommunications companies in the U.S. Blarney is, I think it's up to 70 different telecommunications companies that are participating fundamentally with the 702 program, the FISA Amendments Act program. Then Oakstar are about eight other countries in the world other than first and second party, US, UK, Canada, and the Five Eyes group. There are about seven or eight other countries in the world that are also participating in this program with them. So they're contributing. One, of course, is the BND. And anybody using a program called X-Keyscore is using that to interrogate the programs that collect all this data off the fiber network. But the Fairview program and the Stormbrew and all the others, I think my estimate is that takes in about 80% of everything sent across the network worldwide. That includes content, metadata, everything. Every type of communications, textual, voice, short messaging, you know, video, that kind of thing. If it's video conferencing, but if it's the standard television stuff, they delete that. So that's that. In the United States, though, this was the plan in 2004. They had roughly 100 different tap points in the United States. Of course, it's distributed with the population. But the distinction here is that if they were only after foreign communications, which they claim, then the only tap points would be along the coast of the United States because that's where the transoceanic cables surface. Well, that's the perfect point to tap to get all the data from foreigners, if that's what you're after. But the target here is not that. The target here is domestic. And this is AT&T's tapping points. And I've gone on the web and found the locations of every one of these tapping points, but three or four, I think it is. But this goes worldwide. It's not restricted to the U.S. The reason they have most of the tap points in the U.S. is because 80% roughly of the bandwidth in the fiber network is running inside or through the U.S. So that just randomly speaking, if you tap all the points in the U.S., you get roughly 80% of the world's communications. It's no coincidence, for example, that all the fiber lines from South America run up to Miami and then go back down to South America. That's so all their communications route through and they can take a look at everything they're sending. And the same is true with other things. They rent the capacity on the fiber lines rather cheaply so that people opt to, I mean, the providers around the world buy that space on those lines because it's the cheapest way to transfer all the data. So that's the main thing they do with that. And then this feeds another program. This is really the ultimate objective is to map, as it says right there, map the entire internet, any device, anywhere, all the time. That means they want to physically know where everybody is if they're taking their cell phones around. That's why that theft of the SIM cards from the by the British, right? In that one case, that's not the only company they attacked, though. I'm sure they've got a lot more of them. But they were stealing up to 2 billion SIM cards a year that allowed them then to get GPS or any other access and use your equipment while you have it as you're moving around. And so the objective here was to consolidate that, and all that's done by software. It's not an issue of having people do this. This is all compiled and sorted and categorized by software, and then you, as humans, then you select the networks or groups of people you want to follow and where they've been or what they're doing. It's great for retroactive analysis by law enforcement, but it's just too much data to follow. And what it really works like this is they have the map of the all of the physical layout of the entire network, fiber lines, the satellite connections, copper lines, everything, and microwaves still included there too. So they have that map of the world on the physical map, and then they look at that network with tap points, and that goes around the world. I've got a number of those I already identified. So just my research on the web, you know. So it's open source material, and that contributes to what's called the logical network. This is the physical network, and this logical network is people communicating across that, shows their social networks on the net. So that's the logical network. It's not necessarily physical, the way they're physically connected. I mean, they may be restricted to people within their country or adjacent countries and so on, but that logical network shows your social relationships, and that gets back to all of this device here is mapping that physical network using these devices, which in turn map to the people. So that's how they're following everybody as they move around, and again, they're collecting through the tap points all the content and so on. So they're building up the entire electronic life of people in the world. My estimate was up to 4 billion people who use phones or cell phones or computers or any credit cards or things like that. Any kind of electronic transaction is captured and mapped, and that's all done by software. Alexander in DEFCON 20 said, "Our people there don't have profiles on everybody in the United States," and that's right. They don't. The people don't. The computer does. And all the people have to do is call up that profile, and they get it. That's not, I mean, it was all fairly well, it was simply indexing data against a graph or the social network that's being reconstructed by the externals that are used to communicate. And these are, you can't encrypt these, otherwise the system won't route them. So this is impossible to encrypt, otherwise you defeat your ability to communicate if you encrypt it. So the point is, it's not something you can get around. This can always be done, no matter how well your encryption works. And most of those, in my view, are flawed, structurally flawed. So this is what they're doing. The whole idea here is just to get all the information they can on everybody they possibly can, and have it categorized and setting and wait for somebody to come in and investigate, like the FBI or the DEA, which is what they do. This is how they're doing, this is the extension of this. See, this gives them so much power. They have so much power when they have all this information on everybody. So they can go in and research anybody they want retroactively, looking for criminal activity or anything that implies criminal activity. And so they have set rules for this. This is the SOD, oops, sorry. Let me go back. Where am I now? I have to get down to hit the bottom button there. Which one? Oh, there we go. Okay, thanks. The Special Operations Division of the DEA, the Drug Enforcement Administration. That's a special group put together that includes FBI, CIA, NSA, IRS, and DHS. And they are to look into the NSA collected data for criminal activity. And these are the rules they've set forth when you do that. You cannot reveal or discuss it with anybody. You can't do any reports or files with the courts. Okay, all that's, and you can't put it in any affidavit. You can't share it with any of the attorneys or the court. The judge can't know about it. So no proceedings, and local law enforcement, they can't know. And you can't share it with foreign counterparts. And that means through the MLAT, Mutual Law Enforcement Treaty, around the world, they're sharing this kind of research to go after people in the world, but they're not giving them the raw data from NSA that is the evidence they use to do that. So, and then they take it into court, or they actually physically use this data to arrest people and charge them. And when they do that, they have to do a parallel construction. This parallel construction simply says they use the normal policing techniques to go find the data that would imply probable cause for those people and substitute that for the NSA data in a court of law. Now, what that means is basically that denies the right to challenge discovery by the defendant in a court of law. It's a violation of their constitutional rights. It's also outright perjury. So they're fundamentally perjuring themselves in court. Now, what has happened is, in a lawsuit, Amnesty International versus Clapper, challenging the constitutionality of them doing this, they, of course, denied this happened, and the Solicitor General of the United States lied to the Supreme Court to get that case thrown out. He said if anybody had NSA-collected data used against them in a court of law, the defendants would be told. Well, that's an outright lie. Nobody's ever been told. Yet Senator Feinstein said we've used this program to imprison hundreds of people every year. You know, so that tells you how many thousands of times they're subverting our entire judicial process, lying about it, and they lie to the Supreme Court to get the case thrown out. So, I mean, this is just a total corruption of everything we used to stand for as a government and a country. It's a violation of our Constitution. I mean, violating the First Amendment, freedom of speech. You don't have that. You don't have free association unless NSA knows about it, because every social network you ever develop in any media is already recorded by NSA. I mean, they're doing this for everybody on the planet now, so it's not unique to just U.S. citizens. We're all part of it. And, of course, they're then subverting the law. They're subverting the court process. They're subverting everything. This is how you destroy democracy. And the point is, as I'm going to talk about now, this is a program that requires mass collection, and that's been advocated since 9/11. There was an alternative to that, but they refused to take it because it didn't take cost enough money, but it would be effective. This program is a total failure. What terrorist threat have they ever stopped? They haven't. They've all succeeded. What they'd used the data for is retroactively analyzing who is associated with the people they now know committed the crime. The problem is people had to die before they used that data. That's the problem. So they're killing their analysts because this is too much data. For example, this one program here just is to map the location of 4 billion people. Well, if you took the Five Eyes countries and the 7 or 8 countries that are participating with them in doing this bulk acquisition of data, that they might assemble 20,000 analysts. Now, if 20,000 analysts are going to look at 4 billion people, that's 200 people per analyst, 200,000 people per analyst. That's a small city. Now, what one person could ever do that? It's not possible. So what they're doing is making their analysts dysfunctional. And in fact, the analysts have been saying that. Some of the Snowden material shows that. They said overpowered by overflow, or data is not intelligence, right? They have a misconception of what collection is. Collection is intelligence. That's absolutely wrong. It's not. What you can understand from that collection is intelligence, not the collection. If you put so much collection on top of these analysts to try to look at, you're making them totally dysfunctional. And so you just simply can't solve anything. That's why as the technical director there at NSA. I did a program called Thin Thread back in 1997, 98, 99. And the whole idea, even back then, the analysts were overburdened with data. They couldn't figure out what was going on. So I had the technical problem of saying, well, what can I do to help solve that issue? Well, it was a question then of being able to look into massive amounts of data passing by every minute and selecting out only that which was relevant to an international criminal activity or militaries or governments, for example, or leadership of governments, whichever, legitimate targets for foreign intelligence. So that's the thing that I did with the program Thin Thread. I did a massive graph on everything in the environment and used that graph to filter out what was important based on known social networks, or also based on known targets. Like, for example, if you had somebody with an Inmarsat phone in the mountains of Afghanistan, chances are they were part of the terror network. Or if you had somebody with an Inmarsat phone in the jungles of Peru, chances are they're smuggling drugs. So that we call the zone of suspicion. They fall into that zone. Doesn't mean they're guilty, but they have to be looked at to resolve whether or not they're participating in these kinds of illegal or criminal activity. So, but the whole point of bulk acquisition is a total failure from the beginning all the way. That's the last 14 years we've had of tests of it. Every time it's a failure. But every time they come back and say, oh yeah, we knew about this person. Right? Well, the whole point is if you consistently fail, then obviously you're doing something wrong. Right? That's pretty obvious. So it means you need to change something. Well, the thing they're doing wrong, and their analysts have been even saying this, but the management doesn't. That's because there's too much money involved in this. I mean, it's in the U.S. side, that's almost $1 trillion since 9/11 that we've spent on intelligence. $1 trillion. Now, that's not counting everybody else, the British or the Germans or anybody else. So the magnitude of money involved here is so great. There's such a vested interest by corporations to keep this going. I call this the military-industrial intelligence complex happiness management program. If you never solve the problem, every time something happens, that's more justification to get more money. That makes everybody happy, you see. But in the meantime, people die. That's the price we pay. And democracy, in my view, this is why I'm out here, democracy is not a spectator sport. Democracy is an active, you have to actively participate to keep it going. You can't sit by and quietly acquiesce to things because then bad things happen. So that's why I'm out here explaining all this stuff in spite of the fact that my government's complaining. They haven't yet put me on the enemies list, so. But I'm waiting for that too because I'm suing them also. Right? Another way to do it is you sue them. So this is the second time. First time we won this lawsuit, too, by the way. This second time now is we're charging them with the violation of our constitutional rights, the whistleblowers of NSA and Diane Rourke from the House Intelligence Committee. They violated our constitutional rights. And so, but in the meantime, we get to explain why they did that. And so that allows us to lay out the entire spy program of NSA. But we're not charging them with that, see? So they can't claim. The standard practice in government has been to claim that you do not have standing in a court of law. That is, you can't prove that they've got data against you. That's because they classified, you know, and you don't get to see it. Or they claim national security. Well, we're not suing them for any of that, right? Because that we're only saying this is the reason you violated our constitutional rights, and that's what we're suing them for. So they can't claim any of that now. So they have to face up to what they did in a court of law. And that's going to be in public. So from our perspective as a citizen of the country, we can't lose. Because just filing that formal complaint, a sworn affidavit in court with a lawsuit is proof of what they've been doing and documented evidence. So, and we've got evidence on all of it. So. At any rate, the point, again, this is a worldwide issue. We've infected every government in the world with this policy and approach. I mean, keeping very few people in the highest levels of the governments involved and knowing about this program and keeping everybody else in the dark. We keep everybody uninformed in the rest of the parliaments and the congresses, wherever they are, and also everybody in the public we just say we have to do this because of national security, and if we don't do this, more people will die. And the problem is, that's a lie. If they do that, people will continue to die. If they don't fall back on the program that we were developing, which was the alternative of doing a focused, disciplined, professional attack on the data to pull out and select, it's a smart selection of data, of only things that are relevant so that you give this to your analysts so they can succeed. I mean, if you dump all this other data on them, they fail. And they have shown to be doing that for the last 14 years. So that's not an issue. That failure is obvious. I mean, they've been clearly doing that. So the point is they need to change. And the change should be to a focused effort, which would make the data manageable for the analysts, which would allow them to succeed. And we could stop these people getting murdered before it happens, instead of waiting till after it happens, and then we clean up the mess and we find all the people after the fact. That's not an intelligence job. Intelligence has always been to predict intentions and capabilities. It's not a forensic job. That's a police job. We are supposed to prevent events like a terror attack, not do the cleanup afterward. So in my, from my perspective, that's what I'm trying to do, to try to explain things to people so they around the world so they understand that this is really what's going on. And these are the consequences of that actions and the decisions they made. They made that decision in 2000 because the programs we had of directed, selected attack were running for about a year and a half at the time, and had been shown it was very effective. And they had to kill that because we had a coalition of governments or contractors in the U.S. and the U.K. who didn't want that to happen, because if it did, then they wouldn't have all this money to feed on. So they had to kill that program. And they had help within NSA from the Hayden administration and everybody else also in CIA and around, and the Department of Justice helped cover up all this stuff. So they directed, and so the Inspector General of the Department of Defense also participated. This is all in our lawsuit. So, and we have evidence to show that. So the point is, unless we all start speaking up to stop this, complain, bitch, moan, sue the people, I mean, they're violating your laws, indict them, right? Force your government to indict them. I mean, these are criminal acts. I mean, some people, I think the Italians have done that with some of the rendering people, CIA people rendering. They should, because that's kidnapping and torture. I mean, that's a crime. We need to, because these people are so afraid of sunlight, that it's like when you lift up a rock, you watch all the bugs and worms squirm to get out of the light. That's what goes on when you do this. That's why I like to do this stuff. I can't help myself, you know. I want to go to court with them myself. That's all I want to do. One way or another, I'll get there. So at any rate, we all have to stand up and participate in democracy, or we're going to lose it. Thank you. Oh, I'll just go over here and sit down.
Thank you for that wonderful speech, Bill. I mean, what a depth of insight and experience that you've shared with us as well. I have to concur as well. I mean, you say this is American-led, but yes, all our intelligence agencies are involved. And certainly one of the early Snowden disclosures was the scale that GCHQ, the government communications headquarters in the UK, was not just helping the NSA to spy on not just UK citizens, but the whole of Europe, all of us, to the tune of $100 million paid over a few years, which the NSA paid them for GCHQ to prostitute itself to the American spy infrastructure, where they actually sold their services and prioritised the needs of the NSA rather than prioritising the need to protect British national security, which is their remit. And I'm sure pretty much every other European intelligence agency has been doing the same thing. So this is a sort of metastasizing cancer within the intelligence agencies. Now, some I know, we're going to wrap up now and finish with a Q&A and plenary discussion. I know some of these topics may seem a little challenging, unexpected perhaps for internet days. But I think one lesson I want to pull out of that session particularly is that we have a situation where we have an opportunity in Europe. So rather than continuing down this path with the NSA domination of our intelligence agencies and our infrastructure and our laws and our corporations and TTIP and all the other horrors you've heard about today, we could take back the power within Europe. We could demand that our governments pull back from this dependency on the US infrastructure, the US intelligence, the US corporations. And in fact, this would not be a radical move. This was something that was proposed by the European government in July 2001, after the early version of the Five Eyes spying community was revealed. It was called Echelon. There was a big inquiry, a report came out, and the recommendation of our European Parliament was, let's move away from this US dependency. Let's build our own infrastructure. Let's build our own software, our own hardware, our own knowledge base. It would be a win-win for all our countries in every way, societally, democratically, national security-wise, and of course, money-wise. It would be good for our corporations. And it's a shame that that idea was buried post 9/11 in this big security flap. But perhaps now, post Snowden, is the time to revisit those recommendations, to go back to our governments, to go back to our European Parliament and say, we, the European citizens, want to reclaim our sovereignty. And it would be good for all of us and good for business too. Anyway, on that note, I would like to ask all our speakers from today back onto the stage, which could be tricky because we have quite a few. And this is the time where you can start throwing any questions you have at us. And I'm sure there'll be some questions we all have for each other too. So please come up. And you have to fight for the three remaining seats, by the way. So whoever's first up. It will be musical chairs.
Could I take the liberty of Cynthia? Could I take the liberty just of tossing one question out? You don't all have to respond to this. I'd be curious to know, just in a few seconds, what each of you have taken away from what you've heard. Just the speakers. What you've heard a lot today. People who were in positions of trust, power, authority. Were destroyed, vilified by their governments. You've heard a lot of stuff today on a very wide spectrum. What's the one thing that each of you has taken away from today that remains powerful in your mind?
I think for me it's been learning a little bit more about the full history and development and background of the a lot of the issues here. I've been qualified for 10 years and been dealing with these issues for probably about the last 5 years in detail and building a law firm to advise on some of the issues around it. But perhaps I hadn't appreciated the full level of surveillance and activity going back over the years. You tend to think that some of these issues are very much sort of live and now and present, which they are, but they have been and probably should have been much higher in the public consciousness an awful lot longer before, but at least they are now, and at least we're talking about them now.
For me, I guess I've experienced the reality of soft repression, the ridicule, the stigma, the silencing, and that is very much a part of what I have to deal with literally on a daily basis. But some of the people here have experienced hard repression. And so I guess really the takeaway for me is that I'm sitting here with people who have been where I've been and they're still standing. And so it is possible to fight the powers that be and still end up standing. So that's a beautiful takeaway from me.
I think for me, it's what I share with my students every day in the lecture theatre, which is that critical thinking has never been more important in our society. Critical thinking. So that's it, quite simply.
Well, within with a human bias toward what I heard more recently in the day, I'd say that one key takeaway for me is that mass surveillance has always been unethical and against human rights. But I think what Bill Binney just highlighted here, that it's not just unethical and against human rights, but it doesn't work in the first place. Putting it on the same terms as torture, doesn't matter if it's unethical and and against human rights, you don't even get the results you want in the first place. And I think that's the takeaway for me here.
What I've particularly enjoyed is specialists coming from different fields and giving their expertise and their evidence and hearing similar patterns evolve from all those fields. So I think this is a fantastic opportunity to begin to morph and connect different fields together so that we can be more effective in our pushback. And also, I would mirror what Cynthia said as well, that it gives me hope that, you know, people can go through these terrible situations and come out fighting the other side. And this goes back to the basic question, where do you draw your personal line in the sand? When do you say enough is enough? How do we utilize that and push back as well to protect future generations?
I pretty much feel the same way. I mean, the takeaway I get is there's more people involved and more people concerned about this. And so that gives me more hope. That helps me continue, you know, and it just makes me want to get those guys. So that's what I take away from here. There's more support than you really realize.
I want more questions from you.
On that subject, Annie, could you take the floor now, and I'll do mic swapping duties.
Any questions?
Hello. Yes, during this day, we've most certainly heard that the surveillance state is here. I would like to hear from you, the speakers, what you do on a personal level to protect yourself and make this situation better.
I can answer. Let me answer for my... I'm in a kind of a special case. I'm a direct target of NSA and CIA and the FBI. Also the DOJ. They attempted to frame us, except I caught them at it, so, and threatened them with malicious prosecution. So they went away real quickly. These guys are afraid of sunlight, okay? That's my whole point. But at any rate, I don't do anything. The reason I don't, if I encrypted something and sent it to somebody else, you know, that person would now become a target. Just because the FBI looks at it saying, if you're encrypting, you're hiding something. But if I'm a target and I do that with somebody, then that person really gets focused on. As a result, the other point is, I want everything in the public domain that I say or do, because then the NSA and the FBI and the DOJ can't claim it's a national secret because it's out in the public. I mean, you can't call it classified, so it's out. I mean, I don't give away any sources or methods, but the point is, everything I'm saying is in the public domain, and they can't hide it in a court of law. So those are the two main reasons I don't do anything.
I try to have as public policy as possible. Most of what I'm doing could stand the scrutiny of light. But I have some jobs in Belarus or in China or Indonesia or Colombia where I need to protect my colleagues in the other end. And then I use crypto for my emails. But I try to reduce it as much as possible. I want to be open about what I'm doing. I could stand the consequences of what I'm doing. Even if I've been in prison in 15 countries or something like that, I still act openly as much as possible.
I do use cryptography, and I also use public communications. As in, what I'm trying to do for this is use the entire spectrum of very public to very encrypted, depending on how sensitive something is, how... if I just want to sow noise. In particular, I'm trying to take what I know of the adversary's eavesdropping capability into account and just give them noise. I encrypt for the fun of it. I post the opposite of what I just sent encrypted on public media, like we heard earlier with the TV show. I help other people encrypt. I try to overload the system just a little bit more. And I try to help other people overload the system just a little bit more so that in the end, it'll just come crashing in on itself.
I think I'm going to be asking for your help after this with encryption. But for me, really, sunshine and transparency really are the best disinfectant. I think it was Churchill that said that. And we really don't have anything to be ashamed of or anything to hide. Freedom of expression is a human right.
For me, I'm really new to this whole technological thing. And so I have a learning curve, and it's steep too. But Annie taught me about encryption, which then, of course, I completely forgot my PGP passphrase, right? So I couldn't use it. But then StartMail made encryption easy. So I have a StartMail account, which I use occasionally, not nearly as much. I use StartPage as my search engine. And I don't know if it does any good or not, but they don't save IP addresses. And I tell all of my students to use StartPage as well. And I want to learn as well how to do more, because I think I was with this organization in London called We Are Change, and I love that organization, but when all of the cameras came around, or to justify the cameras, the London authority said, okay, every time your picture is taken by one of the CCTV cameras, you can get your picture. And so what they do is they routinely ask for their, they will stage events so that their picture is taken, and then they go and ask this, you know, for their pictures. And it's sort of like the strategy that was used in the civil rights movement in the US, where if you knew that the capacity of the jail was 400, then you would get 1,000 people to show up and get arrested. So you would just totally overpower the system. And I think we need to use whatever the means is for us to thwart their efforts at this.
Thank you. Given that I run an organization where we advise other organizations on how to look after and store their data, we thought that we had to be quite careful about that. So we are very careful with what we do with our clients' data. To the extent that, we'll certainly encrypt, you know, any personal documents, if it's financial, if it's data, if it's HR records that our clients may supply to us. But when it comes to actually storing them, we thought, well, we need to make sure we're doing this properly. So everything that we store is on a cloud server that is 300 foot under a field in Lincolnshire in the UK. And I always think you need to have a story about exactly where your data is, rather than, oh, it's just here. Well, ours is 300 foot under a field in what I'm assured is an ex-NATO bunker with 3-meter-thick walls. I'm assured that apparently you can go in and there's all the servers. Well, I've been down there and got all the servers there. And then you actually go past some bedrooms on the way, and they said, oh, in the event of a nuclear war, that would have been Margaret Thatcher's bedroom. And you think, that's great to know, and it's by that 3-meter-thick blast door there as well. So I'm greatly assured that my client's data is very, very secure in the event of a zombie outbreak. I might not be, but the data is safe, and that's what it's all about, really. That's just it. I use examples like that to say to my clients, that's why you need to make sure that your organization, if you are using the cloud, you know where the data is. But ultimately, we can take all of the precautions in the world, but from the sounds of it probably isn't entirely secure from someone who really wants to look at it, unfortunately. But when I'm advising clients, I'm saying, it's from a reasonable point of view, you're taking all the steps you are legally obliged to do by your regulators or the law in your jurisdiction. So that's certainly what I try to do. I'm also very careful about who I connect to on social media, and I talked earlier about social media exploitation. This afternoon, while this conference has been taking place, I received a LinkedIn connection request from someone at Bank of America, who I've never met, who, interestingly, had about 250-odd connections. I thought, why have they got in touch with me? So I did a Google search and found that this person has been responsible for a scam on LinkedIn where they get in touch with you and then say, oh, we need to, someone's died, their estate now needs to be dispersed and their entire family died, so will you share it with me for 50%? So you get the idea, but whereas this used to be the dodgy emails from 10, 15 years ago, now it's a greater level of sophistication from someone who's trying to hold themselves out as being genuine on LinkedIn. So just going back to my point from before, be very careful who you connect with on social media and who you talk to.
I'm just going to say a few words as well about what I do. I think when you first approach security, you have to do a threat assessment. So there are certain people, they might be dissidents or journalists with very sensitive sources or lawyers, who do need to think, well, okay, I'm talking to this person, the threat level is going to be very high, so I need to deploy this level of resources. When you're just talking to your mates, you probably don't want to, although it's fun to overload the system by encrypting everything, including shopping lists, which I have done.
Actually, can I just throw a quick question to Bill? Bill, so we all hear a lot about encryption, and this is particularly expert audience on encryption matters. But even if we discount it for one moment, just set aside the fact that it's almost beyond the realm of most ordinary people to set up PGP. We know this. We've got crypto parties, but they don't really reach the mainstream. And it's very difficult. And nobody's really working on usability wrappers so that ordinary people can, and we talk about start mail, that is a good start. But the question I would put to you, Bill, is, with all of your expertise, how important is it to set up encryption? And the reason I say that is, given your expertise in metadata, and the fact that most people, let's face it, are gonna put the important stuff in the subject header, right? And also, we've got so many, infiltrations such as key loggers and so on. Just how important is encryption? Is it just symbolic or is it real? I'm talking about for ordinary people.
It depends. If you're saying something you want to protect, encryption is absolutely relevant. But the problem is the current encryption systems that I'm aware of, anyway, are not that structurally sound. Most of the things I dealt with had layers of complexity, and the layers were different algorithms, so you had multiple algorithms acting on the same thing, so it wasn't just one layer. And I'm not talking about, public key and private key, that's like a community cipher with trap doors, that's the same thing over and over again. So that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about different encryption systems. And I always believe in things like... One of the things I kept suggesting to everybody is just do a simple bit transposition. If you transpose the bits, destroy the integrity of the text, and then encrypt, then all of the brute force attack to try to get to it, assuming any number of trillions of keys, trying to recognize partial text is wrong and will fail. And it also defeats some other things. You can't analyze if, for example, do a bit transposition on files of fixed files of data, and they want to go in, you have phone numbers or addresses or any kind of thing they want to try to break, and trying to assume the encrypted version is the same every time you see the encrypted version, if you do bit transpositions, that's absolutely false. So you can't subcluster data and analyze it that way. That's one of the things guys at MIT asked me, and I said, well, no, you can't subset it, because if you do the bit transpositions on phone numbers, for example, or addresses of any type, then the variable parts are usually at the end, and so when those variable parts get transposed, it destroys any possible encrypted version outcome that would be common. So if you were looking like for area codes or for local codes, the encrypted version is wrong if you do the bit transposition first. It also destroys any number of cryptographic techniques afterward too, so that's another thing that's important to do that nobody's doing. That could be automatically built into a flip and a flop, flip the bits, flop the bits back. Just build it right into the software. It's not an issue. I mean, that's what we did to protect the identities of people that we were taking in with the thin thread program that I built in the 90s. We did that so that NSA couldn't break into it.
Okay, I think we have a couple more questions looming. Yeah. We have four, okay, right. We'll take it in turns. What was I saying? Oh, yes. I was going to share a handy hint with you because we're talking about tech. Does anyone want to know how the only ultra-secure, 100% secure way of talking to another human being these days? No. because, of course, they could be recording you. Okay, so get a piece of porcelain, put one sheet of paper on top of it, put a shroud over so nothing can see what you're writing, write what you want to tell your friend, put their head under the shroud so they can read what you've written, but you don't say anything. And then when that process is finished, rip up the pages, burn them, pulverize them, and scatter them to the four winds. In this day and age, that is the only way you can be 100% certain, unless they found a way of getting an imprint off porcelain, but they certainly hadn't about a decade ago. And I promise you it works, I've used it. Right, question one is at the back, I think.
Yeah, hi, my name's Eric, and splendid seminar, by the way, really interesting. My question is, have you noticed that it's mainly when the perpetrators of crime are, for example, blacks or Muslims, that the government takes a chance to attack liberties and our integrity? And why, if you notice that, do you think that is? And what can we do against it?
I used the case of Elliot Spitzer. He was going after the bankers for defrauding people after the 2007-2008 financial crisis. That was because the banks were passing around fraudulently constructed mortgage packages, and they were fraudulently soliciting sale of them. And Elliot Spitzer, who was the governor of New York State at the time, was going after them criminally. Well, I mean, people felt that you couldn't go after our bankers. We have to save them. So they went into the database, looked at the emails, phone calls, financial transaction, and found him associating with a prostitute, I think, at the time. So that's how they got rid of him. But that stopped the attack. He would have charged them with fraud in a court of law, and they didn't want that to happen. So it's not just that. I mean, anybody who threatens, that's why he was doing the right thing, trying to uphold the laws. But if you think you're not doing anything wrong, you don't understand. That's not relevant. You're not relevant to the decision. It's only relevant to the administration whether or not that's right or wrong. And it's not just Elliot Spitzer. They did it with Petraeus and Allen, and a number of other people. They did it with Jim Risen, and so on. I mean, it's not anybody who does something they don't want to happen or don't like. They're coming after you.
I think my reply would be that Western countries have a deep racist culture still around us. If you look on the decisions in the Security Council of UN, they only accept wars against Muslim countries or countries dominated by people of color. And that goes on. Of course, it has its roots in the colonial times, but it's still part of our deep culture. That's how we think, how we reflect. Some of you remember that guy in Norway who killed 77 people a few years ago. The first question for journalists was, is he sane or insane? If he's a Muslim, you never ask that. They are just bad people, per definition. So we have a tendency to protect when people from our part of the world, our cultures, are the perpetrators. That goes for terrorists or states. And that's a racist culture that we have not got rid of. It's still in our heads, part of the school system, part of the media, part of our societies. It's still much more to be done after the civil rights movement got it illegal to discriminate based on color of skin.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. And what I would add to that is Elliot Spitzer still has a job, and Petraeus didn't spend a day in jail. So the treatment of the other is what you're talking about.
Yeah.
And that is extremely harsh and leads to a justification for the complete destruction of entire countries now is what we are experiencing. Our militaries are not being used to protect quote unquote us, which I'm not included in that us, but US and our militaries are being used to destroy other countries. Now that is a political objective. And so on the one hand, we have people like Bill Binney who were doing a job to protect the citizens of the United States and the rest of quote-unquote us. There, I don't think we need to discount what General Wesley Clark said, and that is that there has been a policy coup inside the United States where certain individuals now have been embedded in our governments and they have political objectives. And so what we're looking at now in West Asia, North Africa, I do not say Middle East, is the reorganization of that part of the world. That is a political objective. The elimination and the eradication of Sykes-Picot. And if you go online, you will see the map that's called the Blood Borders map that emanated from General Ralph Peters, I think he was a lieutenant colonel, Ralph Peters, who was with the Pentagon. And so that Blood Borders map explains a lot of how the United States military is being used. But what I'm surprised and shocked at is how easily other countries are being led in this objective. And I think it goes back to what I said in my remarks about a global apartheid-like architecture that has been constructed and that is now being utilized. So to the extent that I represent the other, then if we can sow dissension based on race, ethnicity, language, religion, then it's easier for these various political projects that also have economic ends to be carried out. The moment you start, what was discovered in the COINTELPRO papers, which is the counterintelligence program that was carried out, that I think it was Bill Binney who mentioned the Frank Church Committee. What was discovered in those papers that was actually written by the US FBI was that they wanted to institute policies that would divide Black people among themselves and that would separate Blacks from whites. And so they did that. They worked hard to do that. So to the extent that they can keep you in your place is predictable. What's not predictable is the outcome when you join with me in my hopes and aspirations.
Yeah. I agree that to some extent there is a lot of everyday racism and probably more, no, it's not xenophobia. It's not a phobia. People are not afraid of other people. They're just being assholes. It's not a phobia. But afraid of, no, hostile to strangers. But if you want the big picture, which we're talking about here, I think you need to look at individual incentives of political careerism, as Cynthia just illustrated, and opportunistic profit. And if you want one tangible example of that, on September 11, 2001, about 3,000 people died in the United States. A couple of hawks saw their opportunity, saw their window, when 19 people from Saudi Arabia chose to attack the United States and promptly caused the United States to attack two completely unrelated countries to the tune of 1.2 million dead people because they made a profit out of it, because they could seize oil from people who did not shoot back well enough and who could keep the US dollar flowing. So that's not racism. They don't care about the color of the skin. They only care that they're not shooting back well enough when they come for their oil.
We have another question here.
Hi, my name is Joseph. I'm wondering how can we engage and interest the mainstream into something as technical as hardwiring freedom?
Usability is hard. Just seizing on the moment here since nobody's speaking. Usability is hard, and it's really hard. I mean, PGP came out, 1991, and it's still extremely user-unfriendly. There has been advances in user-friendliness for encryption. One thing that comes to mind is Signal by Moxie Marlin Spike for encrypted text messaging and encrypted voice calls. It's even one of the utilities that Edward Snowden now recommends, which is there are rather strong backing. But every new technology takes at least 10 years from innovation to usability. It took 10 years from video streaming to on bad porn sites to YouTube hitting mainstream usability in 2006. It took 10 years from blogging being invented to WordPress and similar utilities hitting the mainstream. It took 10 years from file sharing starting on BBSs until Napster hit. Encryption is well past these 10 years, so usability is due. But in my experience, you cannot teach something technically complex to the masses. It needs to be brought to them in a usable form.
I understood your question
a little wider than just for crypto.
One of my main problems
when I'm lecturing around the whole five continents is all
the students from the audience who say, I have nothing to hide, I don't care. And that's a false argument. My next
book is on that comment, I'm looking to hide. Because of course we all have something to hide.
Another mic. And I think if we are clever enough to go through that argument and open up the eyes of people, that it's not only about you, it's not about nothing to hide, it's about your privacy. Ask anyone in this room if it's okay for me to get
the PIN code on the credit card.
Would you give it to me? Could I see your wife's hospital journals? Okay. So? I mean, I tried to come through by asking tough questions to them, and they all accept in the end, of course there is something to hide, not because it's secret, but because it's privacy. And all of those who doesn't care are part of the problem. As human beings, we have two options in life. We could try to be part of the solutions, or we are part of the problem. To pretend to be an observer on the sideline, then you are part of the problem, my friend. We need people to be engaged and take these questions seriously. It's done before. All huge improvements in human life has been based on mobilizing and organizing people, fighting against the powers, the economical power, the political power, the military power, and we have some victories, okay? Not only failures, but we need to do that again, and this time on privacy, on the issues that are central to all of us. I guess all of you use curtains in your bedroom, and you have a good reason to do that. Okay? So raise these questions in a context people understand and tell them if you don't act on it, you are part of the problem.
Could I just add here, speaking as a privacy activist for the past almost 30 years, what we've discovered when we analyze this question, how do we get people involved? How do we get them committed? It comes down to this. Whenever there has been a huge traction on the privacy issue, it's been because of hypocrisy, secrecy, unfairness, or deception. Those are the catalysts that engage and sensitize the public. If you just talk about privacy and security for the hell of it, you don't excite people. If you talk about the deception that is presented to people, and prevented their interest in this, then you start to see whole populations move. Look, the simplest example from Britain, is, okay, we've had some very big privacy campaigns in Britain, but what was the one that stands out as the most violent? It was when the people in North England discovered that the local government had been secretly putting RFID chips in their wheelie bins. And there were bin burning parties. Police were coming out and burning the chips in front of the cameras. It was because of the secrecy and the deception and the hypocrisy. So I have a feeling, and this follows on from what everything has been said today, that those are the questions, those are the matters that can be leveraged to sensitize the public. And I think I've been pushing the privacy movement in this direction for some years now.
I think we have another question. And anyone else, please wave at me wildly. Yes, there and there afterwards. So.
Thank you very much. My name is Bengt Eriksson. I work for the Swedish Parliament, which I have done for the better part of my entire working life. And it seems to me from your comments that actually democracy is under attack. And to my mind anyway, we have no more functional system to get this society to work than through democracy. So my question would actually be, what measures do you think democracy ought to take in order to sort of strike back? Or is democracy a failed system? In that case, what would be the alternative?
Can I take that one? When President Obama said he was going to try to fix NSA, we had a group of people called the VIPs, the Veteran Intelligence Professionals for Sanity, in the United States and around. We have members around. Annie's a member of it, too. But we put together a list of 21 things that the president could do to fix NSA in the surveillance state. And one of the main ones was to have a technical group that would be able to invade any intelligence agency in the United States or influence other countries to do the same thing, to go into their spaces, look at their database, look at their programs, look at how they operate, and verify that what they're saying is true and that they're conforming to the law. And that group would report back to all of Congress, all of the courts, not this special court, which is not a Article III court, it's an Article II court, works for the administration. So we tried this, and we not just to the intelligence committees, because they've been subverting the entire process and advocating bulk collection and spying on the United States citizens, everybody in the world, really. And that's a violation of their charter. I mean, they're chartered to stop that stuff. So they're violating that. We need to get rid of those or at least make them marginalized so that they can't control the flow of knowledge and information in the government or even to the public. That's really, as long as you allow them control and they can keep it secret, which is what they've done from the beginning, then they do anything they want to and they'll never tell you. But if you have this kind of group to invade their spaces, give them all the right clearances, I mean, that's not impossible to do. Congress can authorize that, and they can then invade and make sure that what they're doing and telling the Congress and as well as the courts is true. There's no other way to get the truth out of them, unless you have a whistleblower. That's the only other way to get it.
Democracy is absolutely under attack, and I agree that we don't have a better system. Now, what democracy is really good at is to hold individual people accountable at the end of their term. And as we saw from Glyn Moody this morning, TPP and TTIP is exactly about circumventing, bypassing, and neutralizing that entire mechanism of democracy. If we're looking at the European, not the European Parliament, but the entire European Union, how laws are made there, they're constructed by the European Commission in a dialogue, what they call multi-stakeholder, which in reality is that they invite all the powerful corporations to write the law for them, and then the European Parliament gets to have an opinion on whether the law should look like this or not. They essentially get to rubber stamp it or send it back to the Commission, which then gets to rewrite it, and after that, the European Parliament, in a second reading, has a much higher bar for rejecting it. In a democracy, Parliament gets to write laws. In the European Union, Parliament gets to have opinions on laws. So there is a very strong democratic deficit. Strengthening the democracy is a solution to the problems we've highlighted today, in my opinion.
I talked nicely about the Scandinavian democracies earlier today. I also see them under attack, but for more reasons than what is mentioned here. The main threat I see today is massive civil obedience. Everyone following orders and laws. And that is what we saw in Germany in the 1930s. I mean, not the result of that. When no one questioned, no one go out of the line, everyone following what is told to them by the authorities. That is the main threat I see. And I'm worried about North Europe these days. There is so massive obedience to everything. So when people doesn't have the space and opportunity to protest and act against it, more whistleblowers, more activists on the streets, that is the healthy injection. That is the vitamin cure for a sick democracy. We can't believe that as soon as it is established as a parliamentary system, it will stay forever. It is dependent on a strong, lively opposition. And that is missing today.
We are running out of time, and I know there are two more questions pending, so if we can answer them as briefly as possible or as fully as possible, depending, but let's just be conscious of time.
This is a bit of an odd question, but the impression I've gotten is that the rise of the internet and the spread of the internet has sort of sundered the division between private and public in a great way, and it's sort of become the way we conceptualize the private and the public has sort of, you know, has heavily affected legislation. And the question I have is rather, should we as a measure reassert the boundaries between the private and the public and try to sort of accommodate the different parts of the internet within it, or shall we sort of try to redefine the map entirely and say the internet is a third space which must be regulated according to its own rules?
Sorry if I make that. I think that's a very, very interesting question, because I was recently looking at the fact that indeed the internet has evolved and should it indeed have its own rules, because if you look back, when we started sailing in a big way on the oceans, we had to develop the laws of the sea and maritime issues there for what happens. We've put certain things in place now for air travel, for example. So there are certain things, specific laws that apply if you have an injury on an aircraft, for example. And in the same way, when it comes to air travel now, we accept a certain amount of limitation and interference when we do that. If you compare to 10, 15 years ago, when you wanted to go on a plane, you went through a metal detector and your bag went through the machine and that was it. And then gradually we have, please take your shoes off because of issues there, and please make sure you aren't carrying metal, and please make sure for the last few years it's been all your liquids are in a bag, to the point that even this week there are even more checks that I went through just to fly here this week with even bigger queues, and everyone just, as you were saying, absolutely accepting it and just going through the gates and accepting this. And I think we have to look at that when it comes to what we're doing online. And this comes actually a democratic engagement and discussion where people have to think, do you want to accept that level of security and surveillance? If you do, and you're fully aware of that, well, that's better than the position that we may have now where people are not necessarily aware and it's seen as too technical and they don't want to engage. I'm very much aware that, for example, in this room, we're all very much aware of these issues. So I suppose I'm almost talking to those who may be watching us on the stream where, you know, if you aren't necessarily up to speed on these issues, and the vast majority of people out there aren't, it's something that we need to come up with clear examples and clear issues so that people can engage in the debate and can come to some sort of vision ultimately. But I think it's just a matter of making sure that there is some engagement in that. And even though we've had the scandals and different things and we've got movies like Spectre, I think we still need something more to engage the populace out there in the just how important these issues are ultimately.
Okay, one last question.
I want to say something, but I won't preempt the questioner.
No worries. Everything you've said so far has been very interesting. So I just have to, it's kind of a question, but I'm a journalist, beginningly. I've worked a lot for doing things for kids and youth, both TV and web. Now I'm also a student of digital strategies. And I found it very interesting because when we talk about these issues, and also lots about big data and everything that you can do and all the innovations you can do, all my classmates get so excited about everything that they can do, and they can start doing plans for everyone with the big data. And I'm the boring one raising my hand. Remember, I started as a journalist. I just wondered, could we talk about this from the privacy? And I always feel like the boring one. So I kind of want your tips and tricks to how do I get my, because these people are coming out into the digital world very soon, and they are really excited and really clever people. But how do I excite them for the fact that we should equally talk about privacy and that data as the big data that they find amazing, which it is, but the problems with the both edges, I guess.
All right. I could comment on that. I think what Please you do. Need to tell your students is that anything you write or do on the web, just imagine your mother reading it. That'll motivate them, I think.
You could, if you want a tip for classes, you could say that our parents had the right to send an anonymous letter to anybody they wanted, and it would not be read in transit. It's reasonable to demand that you have the same right. So how would you go about doing this today, given what you know?
I think teaching is a great privilege, and I'm just delighted that you're a voice there for the next generation. And I think, actually, in all humility, the next generation are going to be our digital teachers. So I think I would pose a question to your class about how would they integrate that principle which Gandhi called, I think, Satyagraha, which is the force born out of truth, which justifies rule breaking when your sense of justice has been violated. And just see what they create, just see what they come up with, throw out the challenge to the next generation, and come back to us with the answer.
I've got one. I'm teaching in Bangladesh right now. And the students are very excited about Facebook, right? And so in my exams, I try to make I'm teaching political science, and then I'm also teaching in the business school leadership. And so I try to make my exams locally specific, and yet encompassing of these larger issues. And one of the exams that I gave exposed a company called the Hacking Team, which you guys might be familiar with, that was trying to sell some software to the, they called it a death squad in the article, in a state-sanctioned police. And the students were shocked. They were totally shocked at the capabilities of the software. So I think one important thing is just providing information, and depending on how young your students are, but if they're old enough, the provision of the information is enough. I wanted to go back to the question of the gentleman there who asked about democracy. And what I would like to say is, it depends on what kind of democracy you're talking about. Because for some of us, we've never been included in certain democracies. And so there's been this thinking about how can we make democracy better for everyone. So we have indirect democracy, all of the, you know, all of us parliamentary structures of government. We have indirect democracy. And then what happens is that the people that we elect become captured by other forces, and they belong to them for 3.5 years, except for the half year that they're campaigning to get our vote again. And that is a problem of indirect democracy. But what about direct democracy? And perhaps we can have direct democracy where all of us participate in the decisions of the state. There are some countries that do that now. There are some countries that were trying to do that, like Libya, that got bombed into the Stone Ages. But the Swiss are allowed to have direct democracy. And then there's another strategy that I think should be utilized even despite the limitations of our indirect democracy, and that is that we need to reinvigorate quote-unquote democracy. And the way we reinvigorate it is not with the continual election of people who are already in the system, but infusing new ideas and new people into the system. And so I would say, you know, I always say that people in the audience that I'm in need to consider running for office. That's the only way we can, if you're talking about shared values, then that's the only way we can get closer to shared values. We've got to get rid of these people who are entrenched in the system, which is a system that is, what did you call it?
The Lucifer effect.
The Lucifer effect. I love that.
I call those people permanently petrified politicians in place.
That's right.
Just to go back quickly to the last question, we're asking about sort of engagement with education issues as well. I do quite a bit of going into universities and schools and talking to people who are just sort of setting out on their social media experience on different things and saying, by all means, engage with social media and engage online and use your devices and get the most out of them because they are the future. You know, very often parents will say, no, we don't want them using it. I'm saying, no, they should be using it, but make sure they know the risks. So a number of times I'll go in and sort of say a few examples of people who may have had interviews that have been ruined by someone saying, this is a picture that we aren't happy about where you turned up at a fancy dress party in an inappropriate outfit and it's on there. And for that reason, you know, that can prejudice you in the future. So I just very often use examples of that to sort of say, by all means, go on there, use it, engage it, but do it safely, knowing the risks that could be there. So share plenty of some information, keep other things private and to yourself. And very often I then watch the colour drain from the students' faces as they think of the drunken photos from all those nights out that they'd really rather weren't actually out there to be seen.
Do we have one final comment? Because unfortunately, we have run out of time. So,
well, as my husband would say, I have to have the last word. But I was just reflecting again on Bengt's good critical thinking about democracy, which is that and we've heard a lot of US bashing, I guess, today, but I have to say, upon reflection, the United States Constitution is one of the finest legal documents that has ever, that is ultimately, I believe, going to, that will be, hopefully, the protection that's used. And that we do forget that the first line of the Constitution is, we the people. And we forget that it's actually the people that give the power to the politicians. And I think that first line of the Constitution has to be our reminder that we need to step into our own power.
I don't think we can top that. Thank you for a wonderful final comment. I think it just remains for Simon and myself to say a huge thank you to all our wonderful speakers. It's been an amazing day with an amazing blend of different subjects. And a huge thank you to you as well for listening and participating and for your wonderful questions. Simon, do you want to say one final word?
I'll reiterate too, thank you so much, and thank you to all the speakers. A quick plug, we've talked a lot about whistleblowing. This is a great book by Brian Martin, Support Whistleblowing, get this, and you can have it signed by a whistleblower of your choice. How about that one? For 200 kroner, it's all yours. But thank you everybody so much. Code Red is going to be following through as, you know, fiercely as we can. And, have we got drinks downstairs?
I think it's officially called Mingle.
Mingle at 5.5%, yes. So thank you.